It's a great pleasure to welcome you to this public lecture here at Queen's University Belfast and to introduce to you our distinguished speaker today. Over recent years, Queen's has reinforced its commitment to providing a space for public debate and to hosting events such as this one, at which major figures can address subjects of high importance. It's excellent to see and to welcome each and every one of you here this afternoon, and we look forward very much to a good discussion. Andrew Adonis read modern history at Keble College, Oxford, subsequently completing an Oxford University DPhil, a version of which was published in 1993 by Oxford University Press, an excellent monograph entitled Making Aristocracy Work. Dr. Adonis then took up a fellowship at Nuffield College, Oxford, but opted not to pursue an academic career, but rather to move into journalism and ultimately politics. He joined the Financial Times in 1991 and The Observer in 1996. And then in 1998, he was appointed by Prime Minister Tony Blair to be an advisor at the Number 10 Policy Unit, specialising in constitutional and educational policy. He was promoted to become the head of the policy unit from 2001 until being made a life peer in 2005, when he was appointed to the government soon after as Minister of State for Education. He remained in that role when Gordon Brown became Prime Minister in 2007, before becoming Minister of State for Transport in 2008. The following year, he was promoted to the Cabinet as Secretary of State for Transport, a position he held until 2010. In addition to his many other roles and achievements, Lord Adonis was chairman of the UK Infrastructure Commission in 2017, and in addition to his doctoral monograph, to which I've already referred, he's also the author, co-author, or editor of numerous other important books, including, published this year, his co-authored book Saving Britain, How We Must Change to Prosper in Europe. Normally, when a professor has the stage, they recommend their own books, but on this occasion, I'm recommending a book by our distinguished speaker, Saving Britain, published this year, co-authored by Andrew Adonis. On a personal note, as well as the privilege of welcoming Lord Adonis formally to speak to us at Queen's, it's also a personal pleasure for me to see him again, the first time I've seen him in person since we were both students at Keble College, Oxford, in the 1980s. Andrew, it's great to have you with us here at Queen's today. And so to speak on the subject of the people's vote, why we must have a public vote on the final Brexit deal, please now join me in warmly welcoming to Queen's University Belfast, Lord Adonis.
Thank you very much, Richard. We were both at Keble in the 1980s, and Keble looks a bit like Queen's University, Belfast. The architecture isn't wholly dissimilar. There are still the red bricks. When we were there, of course, everything has changed since. There was a Destroy Keble Society, and the membership fee was turning up with one brick at each meeting. And most of the members were at St John's College, Oxford, which is the next door college. There was retribution committed whenever the meetings of the said society were held. You're 20 years older than Keble, and therefore 20 years in the life of an institution that is that young is a huge gulf. So you're a much more venerable institution. Nobody would dare dream of moving any of your bricks, I'm sure. But it's a huge privilege to be here, and I'm very grateful to you, Vice-Chancellor, for hosting this event, to Richard as Pro-Vice-Chancellor for chairing it, to Ryan Feeney and his fantastic team. This is the middle of... I must say, I'm just astonished at how hard you all work in the middle of the summer. The Vice-Chancellor, I'm sure this wasn't just arranged for me, the Vice-Chancellor took me to your graduate centre, which was absolutely heaving with people, with classes going on, with induction courses going on. And he said then at the end, when you go through, because it looks like a great cathedral, you go through these doors into what he said is the private study area. So there'll be nobody here. There wasn't a desk free. So as an exhibition of the quality of your university and the assiduity of your students, you've absolutely done yourselves proud today. And it's great to be here. There's this book which has come out called Saving Britain, and I'm signing copies afterwards. All of the proceeds are going to the European movement to campaign for keeping Britain, the United Kingdom. I always have to choose my words with care, keeping the United Kingdom in Europe. And I'm a tenor, and I'll be signing copies afterwards. There's another book which has come out because, you know, it's very important, I've always thought, to win an intellectual argument if you're going to win a political argument. I've edited a collection of essays on prime ministers and Europe since Winston Churchill, which has come out published by Biteback with essays on each of the 14 holders of the office of Prime Minister since Churchill by people who've got either direct knowledge of them or historians of that period. And it's dedicated to Churchill, the saviour of Europe and the inspiration of the European Union. And the first essay on Churchill himself is written by Sir Nicholas Soames, who is Churchill's grandson. And you might find that those of you who are looking at this in a more academic way might find that interesting too. Now, the interesting thing about Northern Ireland and the referendum campaign is that outside Northern Ireland itself, of course, it barely featured. There was almost no debate about Ireland and Northern Ireland in the campaign itself on the mainland, whereas now Northern Ireland and Ireland is one of the fixed points in the debate about Brexit and indeed in these very intricate negotiations which are taking place at the moment. Indeed, the Prime Minister is in Northern Ireland today and tomorrow meeting the parties. She is also inspecting the border, I'm told, tomorrow in the company of Eileen Foster. Everybody, every British politician has to come and inspect the border. It's like going to China and walking the Great Wall of China. You cannot possibly be seen unless you have, it doesn't matter how much of it, a few yards will suffice, but you must have a picture on the non-border, preferably with something that looks, I don't know what border-like is, but it seems to be cows at the moment. Some indication that you understand what's happening to the agri industry of Northern Ireland, because it's most affected. So I am inspecting the border, but I'm intending to walk, not a lot of it, because I understand it's 350 miles, but some part of it. And we're all congregating to do that. I'd rather hope the Prime Minister might be in the audience today, but apparently she's meeting the parties, and my good friend Eileen Foster doesn't let her out of her sight, so she can't be here, unfortunately. But I'm glad that she is going to be speaking and setting out her view, because it's hugely important on what the government intends to do in respect of Ireland and the Irish border tomorrow. Now, what I want to give you, if I may, so I want to leave time for questions, is my account, which is in the book, so I'll summarise it, of why we're in this Brexit situation. I regard it as a catastrophe, but let me try and use, because it's an academic audience, somewhat more impartial language, and then how I think we move forward, because we're in a state of very deep crisis at the moment in these negotiations and in the whole policy of the British state towards our European friends and allies and the European Union, and finding a way through this is going to be difficult. Now, being English, I'm actually half Cypriot, but brought up in London. And by the way, the only divided city in Europe, which is gives me an emotional bond with Northern Ireland all the time, is Nicosia, which has still got a no man's land and troops and all that there. So I absolutely know what it's like to live in a divided community, which is which has really serious security threats. But being English, of course, we have a great sense of humour, and the more desperate the crisis, the more we joke about it. I have spent more time in studios in the company of Nigel Farage and Jacob Rees-Mogg in the last 6 months than most members of my family. And so we, being English, we have a kind of banter. And my banter with Nigel Farage goes as follows. I will exchange my seat in the House of Lords, Nigel, for your German passport. We kept that going for several months until finally I got out of him a few weeks ago that he doesn't have a German passport. And the reason why he was in the German consulate was because he was applying for a passport for his children. Now, I don't bring other people's children into political debates unless they raise it themselves. So I said, I'm delighted that his children have got German passports. All of the children of parents like him in the United Kingdom, they all want German passports. So I have this youth group called Our Future, Our Choice, which I hope is organising here in Queens as well. They have all been systematically applying to Nigel to be adopted by him so that they too can get German passports. Because, you see, the best solution, of course, is the solution you have in Northern Ireland. Under the Good Friday Agreement, all residents of Northern Ireland have a right to apply for an Irish passport. I suggested in the House of Lords because...
Only those born here,
right. Well, I suggested that the Irish government should very generously extend this offer to all of the people of the United Kingdom, but that offer hasn't yet been accepted. But an alternative is that they could all be adopted by Nigel Farage and apply for German passports instead. With Jacob Rees-Mogg, the banter goes rather as follows, that when... the President of France, who was in London 2 months ago, made a very great and positive impression when he kindly said that he was going to lend us the biotapestry, which goes on display in the British Museum next year. Why the biotapestry was thought to be a great thing to celebrate Anglo-French friendship over the centuries, I'm not quite sure. But anyway, it's the first time it's left Normandy since the 11th century, apparently. And that's great. But he asked for a return gift. And Her Majesty the Queen has very generously offered to loan the people of France Jacob Rees-Mogg. Jacob will be put on display in the Louvre because he in his person, exhibits all the strengths and weaknesses, or many of them, of Britain over recent decades. Anyway, that got me through about two of my encounters with Jacob. But then we had to do something banter for the next one. So I said that I'd had a further communication from President Macron. He was dissatisfied with Jacob as a gift on the grounds that the Bayeux tapestry is considerably more recent. And I'm still waiting for Jacob's response to that one next time we meet. So we do the banter, but the truth is hugely significant issues are at stake in this Brexit debate, and very significant social, political, and economic forces have led to the situation that we're in without people quite realising what was going on under the surface until we all woke up on the morning of the 24th of June 2016, with David Cameron on the steps of 10 Downing Street announcing that, because of the instruction from the British people, he was resigning and we would have to try and find our way through to a Brexit which was undefined at that stage and which we've spent the last 2 years trying to define and negotiate ever since. And the first part of the book seeks to explain why it is that we have this Brexit situation on our hands. And it's partly social, it's partly political, and it's partly economic. The political is that we have always been half in and half out of Europe, our continent, because we're an island to the west, which hasn't been invaded since the 11th century and has not suffered many of those huge borderland flows of people which have been the experience of almost every other European country. Partly, but also partly because we were not there in the creation of the European Union, and it's always been seen as a slightly, to many people, very alien institution. Foolishly, in my view, we didn't take part in the negotiations which led to the Treaty of Paris and the creation of the European Coal and Steel Community. It's a very interesting historical question whether we would have done if Churchill had been Prime Minister, because, of course, his Zurich speech of 1946 called for a kind of United States of Europe. It's my view, it's also Sir Nicholas Soames's view, which he expresses in the chapter that he's written in my other book, that had he been Prime Minister in 1945 and inspired, not merely inspired, but been instrumental in the establishment of the European Union, then it would have been a British-led institution. It's perfectly possible that Churchill would himself have become its first president. But that wasn't to be. Clement Attlee was Prime Minister at the time. He was what we would now call a Eurosceptic. He saw Britain's, actually for many of the reasons, curiously, that Jeremy Corbyn is. He thought that having supranational institutions would limit the ability of a Labour government to plan the economy properly. He didn't think that we were naturally a political fit with Europe, and he didn't like the idea of French bureaucracy, as he saw it, reigning over Britain. So when the European Coal and Steel Community was set up in 1951, Britain wasn't a member. Churchill becomes Prime Minister later that year. My own view is that, as I say, if he'd been Prime Minister earlier, he would have joined. But in 51, his overwhelming concern was negotiating with Stalin to avoid what he thought was the Third World War that was coming down the track. And he put European institutions as a lesser priority. Anthony Eden, who was his foreign secretary then, was another Eurosceptic who was very hostile to the creation of European institutions, and he allowed Eden to determine policy. So at the Messina negotiations, which started in 1955 and which led to the Treaty of Rome in 1957 and to what we now what became the common market and then the European Community and now the European Union, Britain stood apart. We sent a deputy secretary from the Board of Trade to negotiate alongside the Chancellor of Germany, the President of France and the Prime Minister of Italy in the negotiations that led to the Treaty of Rome. He sent back communications saying that we needn't worry. There was no way these continentals were ever going to get their act together actually to agree a treaty. And if they did, it certainly wasn't going to lead to anything, because there was no way the French were going to open their agricultural markets to German farmers and German wine and vice versa. Well, all of that proved to be wrong. After Suez, which was a catastrophe at the hands of Anthony Eden, when, as American Secretary of State famously said, we'd lost an empire but not found a role, Harold Macmillan, who was in many ways one of our most brilliant prime ministers since 1945, he quite rapidly reassessed Britain's strategic position in the world and its economic interest and applied to join the European community as it then was in 1962. But by then, de Gaulle was president of France. De Gaulle wanted to construct a French-led Europe, which of course he already had the head start on because France had been the moving force in the creation of the European institutions in the previous 12 years, and de Gaulle vetoed both the first and the second British application, and we weren't able to join until de Gaulle had retired. And Georges Pompidou was president in 1973. And we came late. The terms of the institutions, the policies of the European community had all been set before we joined, and we spent a lot of time becoming acclimatized to this half-in, half-out status that we've had ever since. And the half-in, half-out status is brilliantly exemplified by the most dominant prime minister of this entire period since Churchill, who, of course, was Margaret Thatcher. And Margaret Thatcher was at one and the same time very pro the bit of this institution called market and very against the bit of this institution that was called common. And so while she saw it as mostly about a market, she thought it had great advantages, and she became briefly highly enamoured of it in the negotiations that led to the single market, because she thought quite rightly that this was a great opportunity for British, particularly our service industries, to start breaking into European markets, which otherwise we were excluded from. But as soon as it became clear that there was much more common in this and that there was going to be a big political dimension to the common, particularly after Jacques Delors became president of the European Commission, she turned strongly against it. And as I explain in the book, the seminal moment in the Thatcher presidency, and indeed the creation of modern Euroscepticism as we know it now, are the first 3 weeks of September 1988. In the first week, Jacques Delors, as president of the European Commission, comes and addresses the TUC conference in Bournemouth, ironically Tory Bournemouth, but he comes to Bournemouth and he addresses them on the subject of social Europe. And this is what turns the trade union movement and in due course the Labour Party in favour of membership of the European community, because they, until then they've been at best suspicious for the most part, but much of it had been opposed. But the very fact that he came to lecture on social Europe, to which Margaret Thatcher was deeply opposed, turned her passionately against the next phase of construction of the European project. And 2 weeks later, she delivered the Bruges speech, which was the modern statement and launched the whole modern movement towards Euroscepticism, where she announced that we have not dismantled the frontiers of the state in Britain, only to see them re-erected as a new superstate in Brussels. And that was a direct response to Delors and his speech at the TUC conference 2 years earlier. And she then moved dramatically in the Euroskeptic direction, and what became a small group inside the Conservative Party became a larger group, and then by 2016 had become the majority of the MPs and had become the official policy of the party. And in my chapter 3 of the book, which is entitled somewhat provocatively, but it's what I believe is the situation, How Mr. Farage Became Leader of the Conservative Party, because that's essentially what's happened in British politics over the last 10 years, the beginning is the Bruges speech. And it's very significant that the last vote that Margaret Thatcher casts in the House of Commons in the 2 years between her standing down as Prime Minister and leaving the House of Commons, the last vote was when she led a rebellion against John Major's government on, wait for it, a referendum on the Maastricht Treaty. And 20 Conservative MPs vote with her at the time, but the 20 became 40, became 80, and then led progressively to all of the problems which caused David Cameron to call the referendum and ultimately to lose it. So there are big political forces behind Brexit, which, as I see it, are partly to do with a long-standing half-in, half-out mentality, which is partly a function of geography and culture, partly a function of the construction of the European Union and the fact that we were never in at the beginning and always had difficulty accommodating ourselves to it, and partly a function of Margaret Thatcher and an English nationalist right, which developed very powerfully from the late 1980s, as Margaret Thatcher herself, who was hugely dominant intellectually as well as politically, came to see the European Union as a force for, as she saw it, socialism. And just as, because winner takes all in the British electoral system and political system, just as her response to threats inside Britain had been what you can't control, you abolish. So when she couldn't control Ken Livingstone and the Greater London Council, because we don't have a written constitution, as you know only too well, she abolished it. She abolished all the metropolitan authorities. She tried to abolish a large part of local government by introducing the poll tax, which is what led ultimately to her fall. Similarly, her mentality in response to the what she saw as the federalist and socialist ambitions of Jacques Delors and the European Union was to seek to abolish Britain's membership of it, which is then became the dominant strand in conservatism thereafter. So there's a set of political factors. Social factors are hugely important. Almost all of the areas that voted Leave in the referendum 2 years ago were distant and alienated from London, and at the poorer end of the spectrum. There's an almost direct proportion between average levels of education, average levels of income, and propensity to vote to remain in the European Union. The richer the area within England, and that's a very important qualification, within England, the poorer the area, the less educated it is on average, the more distant it is. And actually, it's distant. I'm a former transport secretary, so I live and breathe train timetables. In my day, the trains ran and worked. My successors haven't been quite so good at managing that, making that happen. But the more distant they are in terms of communications from London, the more likely they were to vote to leave. And that's an almost invariable rule across England. And the reasons why that's become so pronounced aren't difficult to understand. The 10 years, particularly since the financial crash of 2007-08, have seen average real wages fall by 10%, a deep sense of alienation and poverty, which has spread particularly in areas more remote from London. The seven of the 10 poorest regions in the whole of Northern Europe, seven of the 10 are in England. One of the others is in Wales, and the other is Northern Ireland. And the richest, by far, single region in Northern Europe is London. So this massive sense of inequality, alienation, distance, all of that came home to roost. Now, as I've toured, I've spent much of the last 6 months touring the 100 constituencies in England that voted most heavily to leave. And what is almost universally true about those areas is a deep sense of poverty, a deep sense of alienation. If the question on the ballot paper 2 years ago had been, do you want a fundamental reassessment of your relationship with Westminster, there would have been a huge majority for that. But the only question on the ballot paper was, do you want to leave the European Union? Plus one other huge, hugely important factor, which was immigration. And in the book, I tell the story of immigration policy since the 1960s, which is very important because my generation of politicians and the generation just above me, Tony Blair, who I worked for, Gordon Brown, and actually David Cameron, that generation, were too young to have lived through politically. They were young. They were in 10 or 11 at the time, the politics of the late 1960s, and they didn't fully understand what happened in this massive social battle that took place against Enoch Powell, who briefly was the most popular politician by far in England. And if he'd been a Nigel Farage and set up a new party, he might well have swept the scene. What they understood was that the violent racist rivers of blood rhetoric was isolated and ultimately destroyed. It didn't become official policy. The bit they didn't understand is that part of the deal between the political class and this rampant populism which Powell unleashed was that we virtually stopped immigration into the country. The 1968 Commonwealth Immigrants Act virtually stopped all immigration into the country. And when I wrote the book, I came to read the debates to understand what had happened. And the Commonwealth Immigrants Act of 1968 passed with a cross-party agreement in 4 days by both houses of parliament because of the threat there was going to be a big new wave of Kenyan Asian immigration in 68, stopped all immigration as of right from the Commonwealth. It followed a previous Commonwealth Immigrants Act of 6 years previously, which had largely stopped immigration because it withdrew British passports from most residents of what was the British Empire. And James Callaghan, who was then Home Secretary and very much had his finger on the social pulse and became Prime Minister a decade later, his speech introducing the Commonwealth Immigrants Act talks about the threat of an imminent and large-scale invasion of the country, which we will not be able to tolerate. Incredibly emotive language. All that separates it from Enoch Powell is the violence and the threat to send people back. But it's important to understand that. And in the 25 years between the Commonwealth Immigrants Act of 1968 and the expansion of the European Union to Central and Eastern Europe, there is almost no net migration into the United Kingdom. Obviously, there are people moving in and moving out, but there's almost no net migration. The flows are quite small. What happens in 2003-04 is a huge surge of immigration into the country because of the admission of the Central and East European states, with Britain opting out. Ironically, it wasn't too much Europe, it was too little Europe in some ways, Britain opting out of the 7-year transitional provisions, which had been agreed as part of the accession treaties, and which all of the other large states of the European Union, including France and Germany, observed, which made Britain the overwhelmingly powerful magnet for immigrants. The Home Office projections were dire, but then projections of immigration always are dire because nobody has any basis on which to know what is going to motivate flows of people across borders. Is it so contingent on particular events and circumstances? So the projection that there would be 15 to 20,000 a year turned into 1.6 million after 15 years. And I can assure you, in all of these meetings I've been doing up and down the country, in all of these communities where real wages have been falling by 10%, in the last 10 years. It doesn't matter what the macroeconomists tell you about net economic benefits to the country. There is really strong and powerful anti-immigrant feeling in these communities. And that, to my mind, was the decisive reason why the vote went for Leave 2 years ago in the referendum. So there are powerful social reasons why Brexit happened. And of course, it was the whole of the anti-immigrant feeling, which was the oxygen that led to the development and ultimate triumph of UKIP. Because UKIP was a fringe party not making much traction until Farage was able to get hold of immigration as an issue after 2004, and he was able to blame both parties for it, because this had been a cross-party conspiracy to hide from the British people what was really going on, and the Conservatives were just as guilty as Labour was. It was an ideal campaigning issue for him. And of course, when we came to the referendum campaign in 2016, there were two parallel campaigns. There was the Conservative Leave campaign, which was much more on the sovereignty issues, the Thatcher issues of economic liberalisation and not being run from Brussels and all of that. But there was the straightforwardly quasi-racist anti-immigrant campaign, which was run by UKIP, which culminated on the day that Joe Cox was assassinated in the famous Breaking Point poster, which is the most racist poster I've seen in British politics in recent times. And it was the gelling together of a set of constitutional arguments and political arguments with a really powerful social anti-immigrant surge, which is crucial to explaining Brexit. And then the economic factors behind Brexit were partly to do with growing inequality and the impact of that on political sentiment, but also because of the way that the European Union had developed from the 1980s, a growing sense that Britain was no longer in control of its economic destiny, particularly because of the development of the single currency. So whereas in the 1980s, the big European project, which was the creation of the single market, Britain actually led, Margaret Thatcher led it. Lord Cofield, who had been her trade secretary and went off to be trade commissioner, he was the intellectual driving force behind the whole move towards dismantling trade barriers and creating a single market in services. The big project of the 1990s, which was the creation of a single currency, Britain was agnostic about from the beginning and didn't support. The Maastricht Treaty, Britain had an opt-in, but John Major wasn't prepared and indeed politically couldn't have taken Britain in at the time. And Tony Blair took the same approach and didn't think that it was going to be possible politically to enter, at least until it was a reality. And as I read my diaries in writing this book and look back on it, it's an incredible sense of deja vu back to the 1950s. Because what's so striking, because you always misremember things until you get yourself back in the mindset of it at the time. It's not only that Tony Blair thought it would be politically difficult to do a single currency, though he did, and all the economists gave all kinds of arguments as to why it wouldn't work, though actually they're just as good as a set of arguments on the other side, a dozen economists in a room and you get 13 opinions. And that was true. If you look at the Treasury's assessment of the single currency, it makes just as good a set of arguments for joining as against joining, actually, if you actually read it. But because Gordon Brown had decided by then we weren't joining, the preface was strongly against joining, which wasn't really supported by the next 1,000 pages. But the driving reason why Tony Blair, who was perfectly prepared to take big political risks, not least in Northern Ireland, and I admire him greatly for the risks that he did take in many respects. His view, and the view of his officials then, was we didn't need to worry too much about the single currency because it probably wasn't going to happen. That it was such a huge project, you know, not simply to have a central bank, to have a single exchange rate, a single interest rate, but also notes and coins, which meant that the French weren't going to have the franc, the Germans weren't going to have the Deutschmark, the Italians weren't going to have the lira. This probably wasn't going to happen. And all of my diaries all the way through are a running theme is we needn't worry, we can put off the decision because probably the single currency isn't actually going to start, which was exactly the mentality of the British negotiators and the British state faced with the construction of the European Union after in the mid-1950s. And it's been a running theme of Britain's chronic and systematic misjudgment of the European project since the 1950s, which is to underestimate the seriousness of particularly the French, the German and the Italian states to make a genuine union, which is as much political as economic work because of the horrific experiences that they had gone through over the previous century. So that's the analysis part of it. What should we do now? Well, the big problem 2 years ago is that there was no leave proposition on the table. Leaving the European Union can mean 101 things. And my analysis in the book is that the fundamental mistake that was made in 2016 was that there was only one credible leave option for the short and medium term, because we're extracting ourselves from a set of detailed treaty negotiations and a whole trading system which had been constructed over 45 years. And that was to adopt a situation very similar to Norway, which was to remain in the main economic institutions the customs union and the single market, with some tweaks, just as the Norwegians don't do agriculture and some other areas. We probably wouldn't have done the free movement of people, because that's the bit that is most politically sensitive here. We wouldn't have had a seat directly around the table of the Council of Ministers, but because we're a very large country with huge impact on the European economies at large, indirectly, we would have a great sway, particularly in service, in negotiations over directives, over services, and that would be a satisfactory and workable arrangement for about 10 years. And then one of two things could happen. Well, one of three things. That could work, and we could stay in that arrangement for the medium to long term, as Norway has, and Switzerland has, a slightly different set of arrangements. Or it could lead to us coming back into the European Union fully, if that was the view of the British government and the British people afterwards. Or if we were going to diverge, because there was a credible divergent strategy and policy, then that could be done over a much longer time period and a credible time period, which hasn't been the case in the arrangements that have been put in place since 2016. The really astonishing thing, to my mind, which is what got me out campaigning on Brexit, was when the Prime Minister, Theresa May, when she took office, immediately in her Lancaster House speech at the beginning of 2017, defined Brexit as leaving almost everything with the word Europe in the title in order to appease the far right of her party. I couldn't understand that at the time, so I didn't think it was a credible policy. I don't think she had actually worked it through at the time. But whether or not I understood it, it just seemed to me, as somebody who's worked in this machine and knows it quite well, it just wasn't going to be possible to do it. It's a bit like the poll tax. It doesn't matter whether you're for it or against it. You couldn't collect 500 quid a head from people living with no income in Hackney. So the whole thing collapsed after 2 years. In a similar way, you simply cannot, in a short period of time, wrench a country out of a complex set of customs and trading arrangements, which are deeply embedded in law and bureaucratic systems and IT systems and all that, in a short period of time. And I saw that as a catastrophic mistake. We, in painful detail, we had 156 hours of debates on the EU withdrawal bill in the House of Lords. And in painful detail, we were going through it agency by agency. The European Aviation Safety Agency, which regulates the flying of planes across Europe. Why on earth are we coming out of that? What is the basis on which we're going to have aviation safety in only 9 months coming out of it? To which the reply from the minister all the time was the instruction from the British people 2 years ago was that we should leave these agencies because they're part of the European Union. Well, as I said at one exasperated moment at 2:30 in the morning, because this is how the mother of all parliaments conducts its affairs in the middle of the night, I wasn't aware from my canvassing in the referendum that the instruction from the British people 2 years ago was that we should leave the European Aviation Safety Agency, Euratom, and a whole the European Chemicals Agency, the European Medicines Agency, indeed a whole set of institutions which I hadn't even myself heard of, let alone expecting most of the British electorate to do so, and which if we'd stayed in a Norwegian arrangement, we wouldn't be leaving. We would have stayed in all of those and phased any divergence over a much longer period of time. Now, what's happened since, which is hugely significant, is that under the pressure of sheer brute reality, the Prime Minister has been moving progressively and in stages towards the Norwegian model. We're no longer leaving everything that's got the word Europe in the title. A whole set of arrangements which aren't quite the customs union but have ever more complex titles to disguise from the Europhobes the fact that they are a customs union have been put in place. And there's been this big movement going on in no small part because of the issue of the Irish border and the fact that if you're going to have divergence, then you will have a hard border and a requirement under the Good Friday Agreement to stop that hard border. And the decisive moment, which is the point we're at now, was Chequers 2 weeks ago, because for the first time, a bit late in the day, but nonetheless, for the first time, the Prime Minister actually declared a comprehensive policy and published a white paper a week later, which runs to 96 pages. And what that effectively is about, in schematic terms, about a third move towards Norway. We're now going to stay in a lot of the institutions which are vital to the regulation of the economy. We're going to create something a bit like a customs union. We're not staying in all of the single market, but we're going to diverge over time. My own view is that if you're going to do that, much, much better is to stay in the European Union itself, which means you get much greater certainty, a much greater say in the construction of regulations and all that. But nonetheless, the position she was moving to might have been workable. The problem she's had since is it doesn't look as if she's able to make a new centre ground that she's trying to establish. It doesn't look as if she's able to make it hold. Because she gave so much encouragement and succour to the extremists in her party who wanted out of all these things with Europe in the title in the first 2 years after the referendum, as she's tried to move away from them, of course, what they're doing is attacking her intensively. A whole group of them resigned from the cabinet immediately after the Chequers meeting. And though they don't have a blocking majority in Parliament, they do crucially have a sufficient body of support to cause at any moment a leadership election inside the Conservative Party, because they only need 47 signatures. And it's because she's so weak and fears that at any moment she might be toppled if such a leadership election takes place that they've got an effective veto over the policy. And so in a situation now, as it seems to me, I'm trying to be as analytical about it as I can, where the only way of getting through the current phase of negotiations with the European Union is maximum negotiating flexibility to move to something like Norway without freedom of movement so that the issue of immigration can be dealt with. And it doesn't look to me as if the Prime Minister now has enough manoeuvring space to be able to do that. The votes in the House of Commons earlier this week, and in particular the acceptance of these amendments from Jacob Rees-Mogg, is hugely significant, because what she's effectively done in advance is to declare that there will be no further movement whatsoever towards acceptance of a single market or customs union norms and institutions. And if that's the case, then we're heading for what looks to me to be an unworkable situation at the end of the year, either no agreement at all or just a bare bones agreement that doesn't cover the generality of trade but simply keeps planes flying and prevents the actual institutions of a hard border being created. Now, what's better than that? You probably guess what my argument is, that we've got to put a stop to this somehow. This whole process was begun with a referendum. The people at the time didn't know what the option on the table was in terms of leave, because there wasn't an option. The leave people weren't agreed. You know, Boris Johnson was busy telling us we could stay in the single market and the customs union, whereas now he tells us that we should leave it. We now know what we will know by the end of the year at any rate, what direction we're heading in terms of a leave option. Parliament will have to decide what to do, given the gravity of the issue and the fact that both parties are to some extent divided, both major parties on it. The right thing is for this decision to return to the British people. And the best way of that happening is by a referendum before next March, or if it requires an extension of the Article 50 process purely for holding a referendum. I think our European partners would agree to that. And the question which should then be asked of the British people is, is, do you want whatever it is that the Prime Minister has negotiated by that by then, or not negotiated as against staying in? And that's what I'm campaigning for. I believe it's in the public interest at large. I also increasingly think it may be the only way of keeping this train on the tracks by next year anyway. Just one final comment, though. A whole new set of very powerful reasons for staying in the European Union have developed over the last 2 years, and they can be summarised in three words: Trump, Putin, and Xi. The idea that Britain's defence and security are now safe in Europe without membership of the European Union looks to me to be not just a complacent assumption, but potentially a very dangerous assumption. All historians, and Richard and I, we spent a lot of time at a university almost as good as this one studying history, know that you cannot separate out trade battles and trade wars from real battles and real wars. The one tends to lead to the other. The breakdown of relations between Britain and Germany in the run-up to the First World War, that began with massive trade conflict, with the erection of tariffs, starting with Bismarck, actually, but going back 30 years before the First World War, in the problem that you had between then a rising power, Germany, and the British Empire. And the idea that we will stand shoulder to shoulder with our current European allies if we're engaged in trade wars with them is deeply, deeply complacent. President Putin is, as one NATO general put it to me recently, is like the hotel thief who goes down the row of doors in the corridor in the hotel, trying all the doors to find one that's loose and then goes in, because he crucially depends upon nationalism abroad and victories abroad in order to sustain his position at home, because he only has an economy the size of Spain, a military the size of France, but the military is at least much larger proportionately than the economy, and using that to boost his nationalist image and support at home is hugely important. He's already invaded the sovereign territory of one state next to him, the first time that that's happened since the Second World War. He has troops massed on the borders with the Baltic states at the moment. Britain is leading NATO forces in Estonia at the moment, who are doing exercises in anticipation of a possible invasion. And when I met the Estonian defence minister recently, he was quite open with me that the Article 5 defence, which Estonia has under the NATO treaties, is great if you can completely believe the word and the strength of the President of the United States. Well, since then, how can I put this delicately? Things have happened which might lead one to doubt whether this is an entirely credible situation. And this situation could easily get worse, and it could be fraught with peril for Britain. And we have been here before, because the great arguments which led to the Second World War and our engagement with it in many ways was the argument between Winston Churchill and Chamberlain, which was on this fundamental question at Munich of whether or not, as Chamberlain said in his famous broadcast to the British people the day before he flew to Munich to negotiate with Hitler, that Czechoslovakia is a far-off land of which we know nothing. To which Churchill's response was that it's not a far-off land, it is the front line of our defence, security and civilisation. And that argument between whether or not Britain's essential cultural, economic and security interests extend to the European mainland or stop at Dover, that big argument which underlay the politics of appeasement is, to my mind, a very significant factor in the politics of Brexit. And I have no doubt whatsoever, the view that I take, and I believe most people who are seriously looking at the threats that we face take, which is that if we withdraw from, in a significant way, as we would be by leaving the European Union, from the defence, security and the political institutions of Europe, that will make our own defence and security much more vulnerable. And in a world with Trump and Putin, that is an extremely dangerous position to be. And it is no accident at all that the two international leaders who are most keen on Brexit are Trump and Putin. And who are their closest political allies in Britain? Boris Johnson and Nigel Farage. And as one of the, because I've got this team of youth leaders who are busy campaigning up and down the country, as one of them said to me recently, as to the fundamental argument that he uses when he addresses groups of students, his fundamental argument is, I do not want to be shut up on a small island with Jacob Rees-Mogg, Nigel Farage and Boris Johnson. And that brings us, if I can conclude my remarks, full circle, because as I now do when I address meetings, because there's a very poor understanding of the history of the European Union, it all began with defence and security, much more than people realise. The Treaty of Paris, which founded the European Coal and Steel Community, has the most amazing preamble that has nothing to say about coal and steel. This is what it says, and let me just read it to you, the first few paragraphs. The President of the Federal Republic of Germany, the Prince Royal of Belgium, the President of the French Republic, the President of the Italian Republic, the Grand Duchess of Luxembourg, the Queen of the Netherlands and their plenipotentiaries, considering that world peace can be safeguarded only by creative efforts commensurate with the dangers that threaten it, convinced that the contribution which an organised and vital Europe can make to civilization is indispensable to the maintenance of peaceful relations, resolved to substitute for age-old rivalries the merging of their essential interests to create, by establishing an economic community, the basis for a broader and deeper community among peoples long divided by bloody conflicts, and to lay the foundations for institutions which will give direction to a destiny henceforth shared, have decided to establish a European coal and steel community. That, ladies and gentlemen, is why the European Union was founded in 1950. It's why it is completely relevant and vital to our essential national interests in 2018. Thank you very much.
I quite like the idea of starting a people's state in Northern Ireland and saying, let's remain in the EU. But more realistically, I wonder how optimistic you are. I mean, I would love this to happen. How realistic is it? And do you occasionally feel you may be preaching a bit to the converted? Can you reach out and talk to those people in those areas you so well described in the north of I'm English, in the north of England, who felt deprived? There was that famous occasion when Gordon Brown, unfortunately, was still mic'd up and had met the woman who was, he felt bigoted about people invading her community. But I think one can see where she was coming from. So are you optimistic that you can reach out to those people?
Yes is the answer, because I'm a great believer that in a democracy like ours, which is a pretty good democracy, I mean, we do have a free press, we have vibrant national debates, we have a fairly well-educated population, in the long run, the best arguments win. The referendum in 2016, so I don't think this microphone's working particularly well, is it? In the referendum in 2016, which was done on the run, there wasn't much time for the arguments to play out, which is part of the reason why people were susceptible to the big lie, because the big lie, you can hold the big lie in a campaign lasting 6 or 7 weeks, which is what happened then, but over a period of a few years, it's much harder. People now realise that there's no 350 million a week that's going to the NHS, that instead we're having to pay a big exit bill. These 7 million Turks who are supposedly imminently arriving on the shores of Britain, they haven't appeared. And it's now clear that they're not appearing anytime soon, and people have sort of worked that out. So it goes with the arguments. So I'm confident that that on the basis of the arguments, we can win and the polls bear it out. But there's another reason why I'm very confident why, if we have a referendum, people's vote, referendum, why we'll win it. And it's because there's been big demographic change in the last 2 years if we hold a referendum. 1.5 million new 18, 19-year-olds, they're very largely voting to stay. 1.5 million 16 and 17-year-olds, because Parliament will almost certainly give the vote to 16 and 17-year-olds in a referendum, as was done in the Scottish referendum. The Scottish and Welsh Parliaments have already agreed. There's a majority now in the House of Commons for extending the vote. There are more than 1 million EU residents who have taken citizenship in the last 18 months for obvious existential reasons. Now, I can assure you, because they're the largest group, interestingly, that turn up to my meetings up and down England, every last man and woman of that group is going to be out there voting if there's a referendum next year. 1.5 million fewer with us at the other end of the age spectrum, including a large number of members of the House of Lords, because this is how the age profile tends to work, and they've been tended to be at the leave end of the spectrum. And the other thing that's very clear to me is that the turnout in a referendum next year will shoot up amongst the young, who are the ones most in favour of remaining in the European Union. So I think getting a referendum is going to be extremely tough and difficult because of the parliamentary politics of Brexit. And I'm not at all confident that we'll get one at the moment. I think it's very much up in the air. But if Parliament does come down for a people's vote at the end of the year, I'm absolutely confident that with a well-organised campaign, marshalling our arguments effectively, and in particular, the young, mobilising the young, that we will win a referendum. And I think we could win it on the same scale as 1975. And I just remember the 1975 referendum because I was 12 and I was one of these precocious people very interested in politics from a very early age. And what I remember about it then is that this argument had been going on for ages. It was the argument had basically been going on in the country for the previous 10 years as whether we should or shouldn't join the common market. There weren't many new arguments that were coming to the fore in 1975. Well, we've now had a massive intent. I mean, just look at the turnout in the end of July, you know, on a hot day, to discuss this. And I find this everywhere I go. Hundreds turn up to meetings like this. There's a massive yearning for engagement in this debate. And I think that bodes very, very well for how a referendum campaign will be conducted.
I was terribly let down. I used to be a Lib Dem. I actually stood as a Lib Dem back in the day in Kent. That Sir Vince Cable and Tim Farron did not bother to show for that crucial vote. Unbelievable.
Well, I was phoned by a journalist this morning who said that, was it true, they said, I don't know who had briefed them, that I had been having dinner with Vince Cable on the Monday when he should be voting, discussing the setting up of a new party. And I said, it wasn't true, actually. I said, but he needed to know that I'm often mistaken for Vladimir Putin. So maybe there's... So Private Eye does twice done a lookalike, though apparently they say he looks if he spends longer in the gym, which is almost certainly true. So maybe there's an even bigger story behind that than you realise.
Thank you. There's a question there, yes. Microphone's coming down. Thank you very much.
This is a random question, but do you think if we had a general election and Jeremy Corbyn come in, what would he do?
Well, that is a real problem. Now, Jeremy is a great friend of mine because we are both train spotters, and so I talk railway timetables with him. Indeed, he's an even more avid train spotter than me. He actually subscribes to Railway Magazine, whereas I only buy it at W.H. Smith when I'm going on long journeys, which is good because we do have a shared bond, because there are many other areas where we have less in common. But on the issue of Europe, Jeremy is on a journey, the far left of which is obviously a part, was virulently anti-EU in the 70s and 80s when they saw it as a capitalist conspiracy and club of multinationals and so on. And they've been on a journey since. And that journey seems to have ended roughly in a kind of stalemate at the moment. And Jeremy just came down in favour of remaining in the referendum. And I think that's roughly where he is now. And he hasn't yet clearly made up his mind where he's going to be when the treaty comes at the end of the year. But the reason I'm ultimately optimistic is that there are only two ways you can vote on this treaty when it comes, or lack of a treaty, which is for or against. You can't abstain on something as big as this, which is what the Labour front bench has been doing on the key European votes up till now. They've been abstaining. Should we remain in the single market or not? Labour front bench abstained. Now, as I said in a rather exasperated way, it's the first time I've ever heard a speech which ends with the world, and therefore I urge all of my colleagues to abstain. I mean, that's not a great rallying cry, but it's not possible to do that at the end of the year. And since I find it inconceivable that Jeremy could vote for a variant of hard Brexit, which is what is all that's going to be on offer from Theresa May, I think by force of circumstance, he'll end up voting against it. The difficult issue is whether he will vote for a people's vote or not. And that at the moment is much harder to gauge because his tactical desire, of course, is for a general election, not a people's vote. Now, the 30 to 40 Conservatives who are pro-European and putting country above party in this, in these debates, they're prepared to support a people's vote, but not a general election. Because as one of them put it to me, I can go to my Conservative Association and say, as a matter of conscience, I've got to vote against Brexit. I cannot go to them and say, as a matter of conscience, I've got to make Jeremy Corbyn Prime Minister. So there'll be a game of chicken taking place at the end of this year. And I honestly can't read how it's going to go at the moment. And it's part of the reason why I'm campaigning in the way that I am, and particularly within the Labour Party, where there's a huge argument taking place at the moment, because it's very, very important that the voice of Labour Party members, which is overwhelmingly pro-European and against Brexit, that that makes itself felt inside the party, and that will further, I hope, encourage Jeremy ultimately to support a people's vote.
Thank you. Next question was there. Yes. Put your hand up, John. Yep. So just get the microphone. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Hi, thanks very much. I just wonder if you think having just two options on the next referendum that you advocate would be enough, given your argument that the initial referendum was a lot more complicated than we thought it was. If the reason for having the second one was the overly complicated nature of the first one, one might logically think that having more than two options might be one way to get around that. And also, I wonder, would you be prepared to definitively rule out, as a matter of principle, having a third referendum if you lose the next one?
Let's be clear, the next referendum is going to be the referendum that ends all referendums. We are not having one. And one thing I'm pretty certain about is whoever holds the office of Prime Minister for the next 20, 25 years, they are not going to be wanting to put the European issue back on the table again if we stay. If we leave, it's different, because I think it may be put back on the table for them by force of circumstance and the views of the young. But if we remain, I don't think there's going to be any question of a Prime Minister misjudging the situation in the way that David Cameron did. The problem with having a further option is, what would the further option be? What would the further option be?
Well, if you think that the problem with the first referendum was that leave meant, as you said yourself, a hundred-fold thing. You can leave completely, you can leave and essentially stay in the single market, you can leave and stay in the customs union, you can leave and stay in the customs union and the single market. There's a lot of iterations.
Yeah.
I'm not necessarily advocating it. Mm. It's a difficult argument for someone advocating a referendum on the basis of being overly complex.
Yeah.
Not to have a very good argument.
Well, there is a very good argument as to why there should be no more than two options on, and those two options being whatever the Prime Minister negotiates or doesn't negotiate, or staying in, which is that they are the only two practical options which can be implemented between now and the end of next March. Whatever she negotiates can by definition be implemented because it's in the form of a treaty. I mean, whether, you know, what the practical impact of it is another matter, but it can actually be done. And of course, we know it's possible to stay because we're there at the moment. What Justine Greening said in her article in The Times this week, which is a third option which would appease Jacob Rees-Mogg, which is a no deal option. The reason I don't think that should go on the ballot paper, and I don't think the House of Commons would vote to put it on, is that it is not a practical option. You cannot implement no deal between now and next March. No deal means planes don't fly, 50-mile tailbacks at Dover, not enough food in the shops and no fuel in the pump. No responsible House of Commons can or should put before the British people an option which literally cannot be implemented. So it would have to be some variant, some significant variant on a lesser form of engagement than the Prime Minister's. But somebody would need to define what that is, which would actually carry consent amongst a significant portion of parliamentary opinion. Now, since Jacob Rees-Mogg and David Davis and Boris Johnson have had the last 2 years to put together a proposition which is at the extreme leave end but is practical, but have totally failed to do so, I can't see how they're miraculously going to do so in the next 4 or 5 months. The remarkable thing about Boris Johnson and David Davis's resignations, and indeed Boris's resignation speech in the House of Commons yesterday, is it did not put forward any alternative policy. All it did was to condemn the Prime Minister for having moved too far in the direction of Brussels. But Boris has not said what are the things that we would have to stay in and what he would favour leaving simply in order to keep the economy moving. He won't address that question. David Davis says airily everything will be okay, but he, of course, as we know, has spent precisely 4 hours with Monsieur Barnier in the last 5 months. So he hasn't exactly been bending over backwards to put something practical together which can work. So I think the only two practical options which could be put on the ballot paper are the actual treaty which Theresa May negotiates, or the fact that there's a breakdown in negotiations and we have to take things on from there, as against staying in. Now, if it's the second case, then I think the referendum will be a walkover, because if the negotiations are broken down, and people like me can go up and down the country and say, you do realise that in 4 months' time, there'll be no planes taking off from Heathrow Airport because we don't have a European aviation safety arrangement. I don't think there's any doubt how that referendum is going to turn out. I think much more likely is that Theresa May will get a deal of some kind. It'll probably be a very unsatisfactory one, but that will then be the deal that goes to a referendum to set alongside the status quo.
Thank you, Andrew. There are lots of questions. We're going to take them in the order in which people have caught my eye. So there's a question there. The microphone coming, please. Thank you very much.
Yes, I suppose I was just thinking whether the issue will be settled even if there's another referendum and the decision is remain, in that all of the frustrations and scapegoating of the EU may well still continue. And arguably, you can see that in other EU countries as well, that this tension between the populist approaches and the sort of anti-establishment, if you like, approaches still being part of the political tension. So do you see that as a risk? And if it is a risk, you know, is there a way of avoiding being in an endless vortex of going back and forth on these issues, regardless of which way the votes goes? You know, particularly from your experience of talking to Leave areas, you know, what will perhaps heal things rather than keep us in this endless vortex?
Thank you.
Well, nothing in life is ever settled for all time. I mean, that just doesn't happen. And if you just look at the politics of the United Kingdom, indeed the institutional fabric of the United Kingdom, just look at what's happened over devolution in our lifetimes, let alone longer. These issues remain deeply contested. Of two things I'm pretty sure, though, if there's a vote to remain, no prime minister in the near to medium term is going to put Europe back on the agenda proactively. It would need to be forced on them in some way, either by some massively successful insurgent party or something like that. The big reason why we're in this mess at the moment is because David Cameron proactively called a referendum. I don't think that situation will recur, because if there's any lesson from the last 3 years, if you hold the office of Prime Minister, it is that Europe and Brexit is the third rail of British politics, and you touch it and you're dead. So I don't think it's going to come from the top down, as it were. It could conceivably come from the bottom up. That's the first reason why. And the second reason why is that actually, part of the reason why Brexit has become such a near impossibility at the moment is precisely because we are so deeply embedded in the European economic and trading institutions. We've been in them, after all, for 45 years now, and that's 45 years worth of... You know, one of the facts that came out in our debates on this is that there are 20,000 pieces of European legislation which are now enshrined in British law, and they regulate almost every facet of British life. And part of the problem is how on earth you replicate a statute book with all of that on it. Now, every year that we stay in hereafter, that dense web of interaction with other European countries and with the European Union becomes greater and greater. So, of course, one can't say that for all time we'll stay in. This issue of national identity being half in, half out, I think that's likely to continue, because it's a deep cultural facet. But I don't think if we resolve to stay in, that the issue will come back on the agenda for a reasonable period of time. If we vote to leave, though, I think it could come back on quite quickly for two reasons. Firstly, because I'm not sure that the leave proposition will prove to be viable. And if it proves not to be viable and we're facing massive disinvestment from the country, people losing their jobs, all of those things, then that's going to come back on the agenda very, very quickly. The second reason why is because it's the younger generation does not want to be isolated culturally from the mainland and to see its rights to live, work and love and across Europe restricted. And I don't think that even if it just about proves economically viable, I don't think that a Europe which does genuinely lead to new borders being erected, and without new borders there's pretty well no point in leaving the European Union. It's not possible to leave, because if there are no borders, then we're by definition staying. I don't think that's going to prove viable with the younger generation either. So my reading of the situation at the moment is that if we stay by whatever means in the next year, that's probably it for the next generation. But if we leave, I think we'll spend the next 15, 20, 25 years in a massive national argument about our relationship with the European Union and whether we should rejoin in precisely the way that we did from the late 1950s after the signing of the Treaty of Rome, right the way through until the mid-1970s when we finally joined. For the best part of 20 years, one of the dominating issues of parliamentary politics in Britain was whether we would seek now to join the European Union, and if so, on what terms. And I think we'll go through an equally traumatic experience in the next 20 years if we do formally leave the European Union next March.
Thank you, Andrew. There was a question down here on the right. Thank you. Just a microphone coming to you. There you are.
Oh, yeah, thanks very much. Thank you. Can I just say, first of all, that I'm a Remain supporter, in case you, from what I'm about to say, you may doubt that. I would have greater worries than you would have about the likely outcome of a further referendum. I mean, the indications from the current opinion polls suggest that there hasn't been a massive shift in opinion over the last year or two. The country is still divided, literally 50-50, as it was 2 years ago. And we saw earlier this week that once Thatcher, May, moved away from our hardline Brexit position, that there was a rise in support for UKIP, indicating to me that the people who had been supporting her previously, you said it was, you made the point yourself, that those people were moving back to UKIP again. So that's what would concern me about it all. And this is part of a greater worldwide phenomenon. It's not just confined, as you said earlier, to what's happening in Britain. We have the, we have the Brexit here. We have Putin. We have Trump in America. We have the rise of the far right throughout the world. These strong men elected in various countries across Europe. The result of a referendum, which would say leave again, which is entirely possible, I think, would have dramatic and disastrous repercussions for this country and for Europe and even for the world. So I think there's a great risk involved in that. Can I just leave you with that thought?
Well, you may be right, of course, but one thing we know, or is extremely likely, is that dramatic and disastrous consequences will flow from leaving. And the job of leaders is to lead. You can't be sure that you're going to triumph, but what I think is inexcusable is that those people, my colleagues in Parliament, whose profound conviction, this isn't a marginal call, whose profound conviction is that this is the biggest mistake we would make in this generation, the idea that we should shy away from leading because we might not win. I mean, can you imagine what Winston Churchill would have made of that? I mean, I think that is cowardice combined with irresponsibility, and we've seen too much of that in British politics over the last few years. And if I may say so, I think this is part of the problem that the Prime Minister has. I've now been in many encounters with her where she's asked the question, do you think it's best for Britain to leave? She never answers that question. What she says is, 2 years ago, she had an instruction from the British people to leave. The job of being Prime Minister and being a political leader is to give your best advice to the country as to what should happen and to seek to make it triumph. It doesn't always win through, and maybe at the end of the day that you'll lose. My own view is that the arguments for staying are so overwhelming and are coming to be perceived as such that we would end up staying, that the best arguments will win. I can't be sure that that's the case. Maybe that will be proved wrong. But because the consequences of leaving next March are so serious, I don't think that we should give up without a really profound struggle to stay. And I feel it as a massive sense of duty to do so.
I think we were very ignorant of the consequences of leaving a couple of years ago. The decision was made based on very little information. We've had a huge amount of information in the last couple of years. Ireland has moved centre stage. People understand the issues much more. However,
The opinion polls have moved. The latest opinion polls in Northern Ireland show that more than 70% in Northern Ireland are now for staying. The opinion polls nationally show a decisive majority for remaining. And the crucial thing about how they're moving, because they've been moving steadily in the last year, is that between 70 and 80% of both people who voted in 2016 leave and remain think that the negotiations are going extremely badly. And that is very bad news for those who want to sell a leave proposition in a year's time. So on the basis of being coolly analytical about the polls at the moment, it looks to me as if we would win. And that's even not allowing for the big demographic factors that I referred to earlier that I think at this time going to be decisive on the pro-Remain side. So I think actually, even if you look at it coolly and analytically, we can win. But we certainly won't win unless we lead. And what we've had a massive absence of in British politics over the last 5 years is leadership, and it's about time people started leading.
Thank you. There are lots of questions. The next one is down here at the front. Please, if the microphone could come down. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So thank you so much for your thought-provoking and informative lecture you've given us all here today. It's certainly the easiest vote that I've ever taken in the long time that I've been able to vote. But my principal worry is Plan B, as I think this decision that you're proposing in this referendum is even more complex than the original decision that was made to the British public. Let's say it goes to a second referendum and the British public reject the terms of Brexit set out by Theresa May. But surely people will be rejecting for their different views. Some will do so for purely anti-Brexit sentiment, and some will vote in a bojo, not hard enough, prospective Jacob Rees-Mogg kind of way. Surely if the vote went this way, Britain would be even weaker and a more divided country than we do at the moment. And obviously, you're proposing this in the hope that it will never get to that stage. But I think with recent events, you should never underestimate anything. And this, if it did go this way, surely we'd be left with no clearer idea of how to implement Brexit. Because of the nuance of response.
Well, the proposal I was making, which is the one that is the is what would happen if there is a people's vote or referendum, is not that people are given the choice to accept or reject the treaty, but to make the same choice that Parliament will have to make at the end of the year, which is, do you accept this treaty or do we stay in the European Union? That is the actual choice that the country faces. And some sovereign body in the United Kingdom has to make that choice. If it's not made by the people in a referendum, it will have to be Parliament. It has to be made because we don't rule by decree. The government can't simply decree that the treaty comes into force. So that is the choice. And though it's absolutely true that people will vote one way or another for a whole set of different reasons, nonetheless, they will have to make that choice in the same way as MPs and members of the House of Lords will have to make that choice when it comes to them. And that is the only choice which can be made practically at the end of this year or the beginning of next year when the treaty comes. Now, if people vote to go with the Prime Minister's treaty, then I think that that is potentially fraught with danger for the country in due course. But on your argument, we're not in any worse position than we would have been otherwise, because that is the proposition that she was going to implement in any event. We're not in a worse position. We could be, though, of course, in a substantially better position if the country goes, as I think it would do, in favour of staying in the European Union. So it's not the point about it being overly complex and more complex than 2 years ago. I don't accept that at all, because the proposition will be a very straightforward proposition. Whatever it is that Theresa May presents to Parliament, as against staying in the European Union. And that's a much more straightforward proposition than we had 2 years ago, because 2 years ago, nobody knew what leave was going to mean because there was no leave proposition. This time, there will be a leave proposition, and it's on that basis that people can decide whether they like that or stay in the European Union.
Thank you, Andrew. Next question here, this one with the blue laptop. Thank you.
Thank you. If we do somehow stay in the EU entirely, we can't return to a pre-2016 world. The UK spent the last 2 years making a fool of themselves on the international stage and caused immense damage to the UK-EU political relationship. So if we stay in, what do you see the UK's role as being? And crucially, do you see the UK joining Schengen and the Eurozone?
No. No, I don't see us joining Schengen and the Eurozone. I mean, can you imagine at the moment making an argument as to why? I'm sorry, we know you've got really serious doubts about this European integration project, but just so we're going to absolutely put it to you, you're now going to have to join everything, including all those things which is a matter of policy we've negotiated that we're not going to join in the previous 20 years. So I don't see that. The bit I don't accept, though, is your first point about us having made a fool of ourselves. I mean, it hasn't been Britain's finest hour. But then, in many ways, it hasn't been Italy's finest hour. We've had the rise of the National Front in France. That hasn't been in France's finest hour. The 7 months it took Germany to form a government, 7 months after the last German elections, that hasn't been their finest hour. Have you spotted what's going on in Hungary and Poland at the moment? I don't think it's fair to say it's their finest hour either. Indeed, almost the only country that seems to have had an absolutely brilliant last 2 years of it is Ireland, which has conducted these two phenomenal referendums, has modernised itself greatly. quickly and is a force, a beacon of hope and light compared to its neighbour to the east. So we all need to emulate Ireland and we'll be fine, but that's a smaller country in the European Union at the moment. The fact of the matter is, all countries have their ups and downs. That doesn't mean to say that you sever your essential economic, political and defence relationships just because you have a spat of a kind that, or a set of difficulties that all countries have at any given time. However, I would qualify it in one way, which is quite important. Though I think we've behaved fast and loose with our economic interest, and I greatly regret that, and I hope we put that right over the next year, we have been an absolutely steadfast and reliable security partner to our European allies over the last 2 years. It is Britain that is leading the NATO forces in Estonia at the moment. We spend more on defence than any other country in Europe besides France. Without France and Britain, and in highly complementary defence forces, there would not be anything which could pass by the name of European security, which wasn't almost entirely dependent on the United States. The joke which a senior NATO general told me recently is, what does the German army of May 1945 and May 2018 have in common? In both months, there are only three functioning tanks. You know, this is the reality. Britain, don't undersell what we do. We are a phenomenally effective and reliable defence and security partner to our European allies and to the United States. In a world of Putin and Trump, that counts for a lot. And though it is true that we've gone through this kind of schizophrenic phase in terms of our membership of the Union, we haven't gone through anything like the lurch towards populist and dangerously populist politics that some of our neighbouring European countries have gone through. Our official opposition is not a far-right extremist party as it is in Germany. The runner-up in our last general election was not the National Front, as it was in France. You don't have two populist parties forming the government, as we do in Italy, and so on. So never underplay the strength of our country and its essential reliability. For reasons that I explained, we haven't been going through our finest hour in respect of our membership of the European Union, but we haven't been proposing to withdraw from European defence and security relations. And indeed, because you always learn something from the previous generation, I think the reason why we haven't is because we were so badly scarred by the experience of the 1940s, 30s, 40s and 50s, when we did play fast and loose with the British security interest, and that did such enormous damage to our national interest and to European stability that the one lesson this generation of politicians, including actually the Farages and the Rees-Moggs, who don't go on about Article 5 of the NATO Treaty as being some great offence against our sovereignty, even though it pledges us in all circumstances whatsoever to go to war if one of the other 28 member states of NATO is invaded. They don't go on about that as a massive invasion of our sovereignty. And the reason I think they don't is because if one lesson really has been learnt from the generation before ours, it's that if you play fast and loose with defence, and you don't give reliable defence and security guarantees, then particularly in respect of our alliance with the United States and with France and Germany, the two key alliances on which our security depends, then this could end in tears.
Thank you. There's a lot of questions. The next in line was the question up at the back on the left, please. Yes, thank you very much. Microphone's on its way. Thank you.
I think it's a welcome opportunity at any chance for England and Wales to change their mind and correct the mistake they made 2 years ago. But in this city and in this place, this discussion is academic. We made our decision in Northern Ireland, and we give a very clear endorsement of staying within the European Union, something which has become fundamental to the complex arrangements that make this place one that is at peace, one which should have a government, but at the moment doesn't, and one where people can work and live together. Now, I think it is totally and utterly regrettable that politicians in London have decided to abandon a lot of the principles wrapped up in the Good Friday Agreement, and in particular, the Conservative Party, who have allowed the DUP, who have always been opposed to the Good Friday Agreement, to undermine it in a number of the significant votes that have passed through the House of Commons around things like the customs union, the single market, and all the things that could prevent a hard border in this place. But I'm even more so disappointed that the Labour Party, who should count as one of their greatest achievements, the Good Friday Agreement, have not been as strong as they should be in defending those principles and defending this place and the vote that we took here to remain within the European Union. So how do British politicians, 20 years on from the Good Friday Agreement, which was hailed as one of their greatest successes, how do they look future generations in the eye and say, we are prepared to wreck all of that in order to bring about this folly, this mistake?
By holding a people's vote, by winning it. And after we've won it and we've reversed it, then we can look them in the eye because the horrors that you've described haven't taken place. That's the only way. If it goes through, then everything you've said, sir, will be correct and will be absolutely justified, the next generation to say it to us. But this is still work in progress. It hasn't happened yet. We have a crucial 8 months ahead. And remember Harold Wilson said, a week is a long time in politics. Well, Westminster at the moment, a day is an eternity. So there's plenty of time still for us to put it right. But can I also turn the tables on you? It's not... because this is work in progress and we can influence it, we shouldn't stop seeking to influence it. I am well aware of the strength of feeling in Northern Ireland, and I completely agree with it. I agree with everything you said about the Good Friday Agreement. I agree with everything you said about the DUP and the relationship with the Conservative Party and how unhealthy that is at the moment. And I agree with everything you said about Europe. But it is not too late to stop it. Now, on the 20th of October, I'm hoping we will get a million people on the streets of London demanding a people's vote. It would be great to have a big demonstration in Belfast sometime in the next few months calling for a people's vote. That is something which can be done here in Northern Ireland, which will help to put the pressure on these politicians in Westminster. What we need is, some of us are trying to work, as it were, from the top down within Westminster, but we need a massive sense of people power from the bottom up. And that's something which everyone can do, play their part in. It's part of the reason why I'm doing a lot of youth engagement things over the next 24 hours, and I'm very keen to get students organised seriously in the universities and colleges of Northern Ireland, like other parts of the United Kingdom, because if that people power really makes itself felt over the course of the next 4 or 5 months, that will have an impact on these parliamentary decisions at the end of the year. So I look forward to seeing you in the streets of Belfast when we get hundreds of thousands calling for the people's vote and saying that we do not want the future of Northern Ireland to be determined by Arlene Foster in cahoots with Tory politicians behind closed doors in Westminster, defying the will and view of the majority of people in Northern Ireland.
Thank you very much. There's a question there on the right-hand side there. Thank you very much.
This question comes from an Irishman and a European, and it's in response to the answer you gave to the lady down below. Imagine I'm French or German. Why should I allow you back in if you still insist on being half in and half out? If I want European integration to proceed faster, shouldn't a long period of British aversion therapy on the outside be helpful?
Well, of course, that's precisely the view that de Gaulle took, which is the reason why he vetoed British membership in 1962 and 1968, precisely that view, that we wanted to be half in, half out, that this wasn't viable, and that it might actually sap the energy of the six founding members. But the reason why this people's vote is so urgent is that until the 29th of March next year, we can unilaterally withdraw our notice of leaving the European Union, what's technically called the Article 50 notice. We can withdraw it, and because it's withdrawn, we stay in on the same terms. And Lord Kerr, who was the senior diplomat who negotiated Article 50 with John Major as part of what became the Lisbon Treaty, he is very clear, as are most of the European lawyers, that until we have left the European Union on the 30th of March next year, we have a unilateral right to withdraw the notice. And if we withdraw the notice before then we stay in on exactly the same terms. Mm-hmm. So whilst it might be true that some in France and Germany, the last thing they want to do is to engage in more traumatic negotiations with Britain over the next 10 years. Provided we get our act together and, and make our move before the end of next March, we are in control of our destiny. Where you're completely right is if we leave after the end of next March and have to reapply to join, then we get involved in exactly the same problems as Harold Macmillan, Harold Wilson and Edward Heath had in the 1950s, 60s and 70s, where we're outside, we're a supplicant, we're dealing with an even more complicated situation then because there are 27 other members now, whereas then at least there are only six others. And I think you're right that many will say, after all that we've gone through at the hands of Britain being half in, half out for the previous generation, should we really subject ourselves to this again? It's a very powerful argument which I and others will use if we have a people's vote as to why it's absolutely imperative that we take this decision now, because we don't have an option just to stay in on the current terms if we don't exercise it immediately.
Thank you. There's a question from the gentleman in the red T-shirt there. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Hi, I'm from one of the, I'm from Boston, Lincolnshire, which is...
the highest Leave votes in England.
And yeah. You said, you're right when you said about the whole social issues. What would you do to readdress it? Because if you address that, the whole Leave vote would just completely collapse and that would make the whole issue go away. Just wondering what you propose to...
On immigration...
Because like, there's other issues too, like you said, like poverty is... like a lot of people are a lot less well off where I'm from as opposed to, say, London, where the...
Yeah.
I'm just wondering what your policy would be on how to address that.
So do you say my policy on immigration?
On the social issues, was it on poverty and so forth?
Right, no. Well, let me deal with the social issues and immigration. On the social issues, we have to get real about big social reform and seeing that a lot of these problems are put right. You know, why is it we still don't have a proper apprenticeship route for the 50% who don't go to university, which is a huge cause of alienation and dislocation in these communities up and down the country? Why is it that we have massive austerity in local authority services, which these communities are crucially dependent, particularly with rising population and immigration, which was a big factor over the previous 10 years. Why have we not got to grips as a country with the housing crisis, which has been bedeviling a good two-thirds of England, which has had rising population, where we're building fewer houses than at any time since the 1920s? We need to get real in dealing with all of these issues. And I believe that's a matter of willpower and mobilisation on the part of government. It's partly an ideological question too, because in my view, it involves social democratic type solutions, not free market right wing type solutions. And part of the reason why we're Brexiting is that the people on the right, many of them, would far rather talk about leaving the European Union than getting to grips with the social crisis, particularly if it involves dealing with big issues of inequality, public services and taxation that they would much rather shy away from. So we need to get real on all of those. And in my book, I have several chapters which go through what we need to do. The genuinely difficult issue, which I don't have a magic wand to deal with, is this issue of immigration. Which is genuinely difficult because of the requirement for free movement within the European treaties. But I do think we can get a substantial part of the way there by having identity cards and proper controls within the existing European rules, which we haven't chosen to exercise as members of the European Union. So in Belgium, if you haven't got a job within 3 months... so can't sustain yourself, you are required to leave the country. And that is absolutely consistent with European law. The reason why we can't do that in Britain is we don't know who's been here for 3 months because we have no proper system of identity card. We don't have any system of identity cards. We don't count people in or out properly because people travel to and from on different passports and different travel documents. We've got no idea who's in the country and who isn't. And so we've got no capacity to enforce the rules that are currently available within the European Union. And the great irony is that the reason why we haven't got many of those controls in place is precisely because of the people who were in favour of Brexit, playing the populist card 10 years ago against the then Labour government. Mm. They said all forms of identity control, even though almost every other European country has them, are a sin against liberal values. And they kiboshed precisely the arrangements which would have made it possible to have had much more stringent controls within existing European law of who's in the country, who's not in the country, who has access to public services, who doesn't, who is sustaining themselves adequately with a job, and who's not. And so I think if we got tough on those issues, And in the book, I propose that we do introduce identity cards. We do what almost every other European country does, so we know who's in the country, who has a right to public services. Those who haven't got a job after or can't sustain themselves after 3 months, they're required to leave. If we did all of those things, then to the people of Boston, Lincolnshire, which has had this massive immigrant surge in the last 15 years, this was a big part of the reason why they voted to leave, we'll have a much more convincing answer in the next referendum than we had in the last one.
There are, I know, very many more questions, but I'm afraid we're going to have to bring the session to an end. Andrew, you can tell from the attendance and from the engagement in questions how interested people are to hear your views and engage with them, and it's been a fabulous occasion. As Andrew said, he'll be prepared to sign copies of Saving Britain for those who want afterwards to come up and buy a copy of it. Three brief things in conclusion. First, thank you to all of you for attending, for engaging so enthusiastically and articulately with great questions. Second, thank you to Ryan Feeney and the public engagement team for the wonderful organisation of the event. But most of all, for a wonderful lecture and a great fielding of questions. Please now join me in thanking our speaker, Andrew Adonis.
Can I say a big thank you? Can I be very, very cheeky and ask a question of you, because I believe in interaction, ask a question of you before we disperse. You've heard the debate and discussion over the last hour and a half. How many of those here this afternoon think we should have a people's vote on whether we continue as a member of the European Union?
That's a good endorsement.
And how many are against? Well, I think it's fair to say, isn't it, that's overwhelming. I will report that back to the House of Lords in our debate. We're debating the current European situation on Monday, and I will begin my speech by saying that I've conducted a scientific test of opinion amongst the people of Northern Ireland. They are overwhelmingly in favour of the people's vote.
Thank you very much.
I'm very happy to sign books now.